The South American Division of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, on July 8, they took an action approving the ordination of women elders in that territory. Now, according to this Adventist World article, there was a reason they took that action, and here is what it says, quote, "The context for ministry during the COVID-19 pandemic and post-pandemic has made it crucial to affirm the leadership and missionary role of the church elder, including women," unquote. But the Seventh-day Adventist Church is a Protestant denomination. We're a prophetic movement. God wants us to draw people to His Word, not away from His Word, toward the Scriptures, not toward culture. We should be helping people come close to what the Bible says in belief and practice, and not further and further away from it. And it's difficult to see how after 2,000 years of the church going through every kind of disease and trouble along the way, many of which were dramatically more deadly than this one, which is 99.9% survivable by most people, let's be honest. And why after 2,000 years we suddenly need to add women as elders because we don't have enough men? Because what? Because most of the men died in the COVID pandemic? I don't think so. Now, what we've seen in the secular world is that human governments have used this crisis to bring in a great loosening of voter verification, and they've done weird things with elections on the basis of this changes. They have used this crisis to reduce personal liberty, to suppress personal liberty. We have people being good doctors and good people being censored on the internet because their views don't match what the big tech firms want them to have. I mean, there's been a lot of things that have happened because of this, and we see it in the world of man, and we say, okay, it doesn't surprise us. But then to see this same approach used in the church to bring in an unbiblical agenda, it's frankly demoralizing. Why do we have to change after 2,000 years? The Bible hasn't changed. The Bible doesn't teach something suddenly different. But let's look and see what does the Bible teach on these points. For example, Titus chapter 1, verses 5 to 9. "For this reason I left you in Crete, that you should set in order the things that are lacking and appoint elders in every city as I commanded you. If a man is blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of dissipation or insubordination, for a bishop must be blameless as a steward of God, not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money, but hospitable, a lover of what is good, sober-minded, just, holy, self-controlled, holding fast the faithful word as he has been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and convict those who contradict." Those are the qualifications given in Titus for an elder. Did you notice what it said? That elder should be the husband of one wife? It's verse 6, and here we have it in the Greek New Testament. Okay, in the Greek New Testament, "Itis estin anenkletos, mias gynekos aner." Mias, one, gynekos, woman, aner, man, a one-woman man, a husband of one wife. This is what the Bible's saying. And this word aner, that's the Greek word for man, in almost every case in the New Testament, it's male-specific. And then the word gynekos, that word is 100% of the time, that is female-specific. That's never used of anything but a woman in the Bible. So here in Titus, again, what do we have? It said in verse 9, "holding fast the faithful word as he has been taught." Now, how can a woman elder be teaching God's things, and by being a woman elder, she's in contradiction to the Bible itself? How can she then be persuasive in any of her other teaching when her very life testifies to the fact that she's in contradiction to the Bible? She's suppressing the truth of the Bible. So the Bible's very clear. How could it be any clearer? But this is just one passage. Let's go back a couple of pages to another letter from Paul. This would be 1 Timothy chapter 3. And we have there's seven verses there we read when we ordain an elder. Let me read those qualifications for an elder in the Bible. And notice if there might be a problem if we start ordaining women elders. Here's what it says. "This is a faithful saying. If a man desires the position of a bishop, he desires a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, temperate, sober-minded, of good behavior, hospitable, able to teach, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not covetous, one who rules his own house well, having his children in submission with all reverence. For if a man does not know how to rule his own house, how will he take care of the church of God? Not a novice, lest being puffed up with pride, he fall into the same condemnation as the devil. Moreover, he must have a good testimony among those who are outside, lest he fall into reproach in the snare of the devil." Now, you probably noticed at chapter 3, verse 2 here, we had the same thing going on, right? So let's read it again out of the Greek New Testament and see if we find the same stuff. Verse 2. Dion ton episkopon anapilemto nina, mias gynekos andra. And on it goes. Mias, one, gynekos, woman, andra, man, a one-woman man, a husband of one wife. And that's one of the qualifications for an elder. And we've just looked at a couple of these passages, but here it's very clear. In fact, the language couldn't have been any more sex-specific than it is here in these places. And then we can go to this giant volume here, which sort of takes up the screen here. This is BDAG. This is the world-known ultimate lexicon of the Greek language and of the Bible. Let's look here and see what we find at page 79. Here we go. And I want you to see here that it's quite interesting what we have. For this word, it says, the number one meaning, an adult human male, man or husband. And it goes on through different variations in contrast to woman, a man, and in contrast to a child, a man, and so on. So this isn't anything strange. This isn't something that is vague or hard to understand. In fact, it's very clear. It's very easy to understand in the Bible. So, friend, you know, the case is we love our sisters in the churches. The church couldn't have done the many things the church has done for these 2,000 years without our women. I mean, that's a bare fact. But it's also true that you do not have to have the title of elder to do many of the things that we do. We don't have to have the title of elder to give a Bible study. We don't have to have the title of elder to be involved in almost anything that happens in the church. There's a limited number of things where we must be an elder. And then when we must be an elder, that again is limited to a spiritually qualified, male-specific individual because God designed it that way. We didn't design it that way because God designed it that way. And I'm sad to say it, but this ill-timed decision by the leaders of the South American division does not represent the broad consensus, the viewpoint of most members of our church, either in South America or in the world church. The world church is not in favor of this. This is going to have a very dark and negative effect on our churches. And let me show you how. When one of our workers goes and he approaches somebody, maybe somebody who has quite a good familiarity with the Bible, and he wants to bring Jesus' third angel's message to them, and they say, hey, wait a minute, I've heard that your church now ordains women as elders. What's the biblical basis for that? That's the magic question. And when they ask, what's the biblical basis for that, what are our people going to say? And we will be able to very quickly just close the Bible and say, we do not have a biblical basis for that. We're just doing it because we need it because of the pandemic. Oh, come on. How is that going to fly with a non-Seventh-day Adventist, with somebody who loves the Bible and is open to present truth, and we come along and say, well, some of our practices are based on the Bible, and some of them are based on a flight of fantasy. And they say, well, they might be right about Jesus, they might be right about the Sabbath, they might be right about the prophecies, but they're certainly unbiblical when it comes to women elders. And so how do I know they're not also unbiblical when it comes to prophecy? How do I know they're not also unbiblical when it comes to Jesus? How do I know they're also not unbiblical when it comes to what they say about God's Ten Commandment law and his seventh-day Sabbath? Friends, we destroy our credibility when we pass outside the Bible and we begin teaching things that the culture began to teach in the 1960s and 1970s, things that the church in all of its history has never done. Why would we do this? And so to continue the practice of ordaining women as elders, just now, when the church has opportunity to be a voice to the world for the kingdom of God, and then to turn back and do what we're doing on the basis of culture with no Bible basis really whatsoever, that's to place ourselves in rebellion to him. That's to place ourselves where his blessing is not within reach. God can help us turn back to him. It's not too late. It's not too late to fall on our knees and say, we want to go back and revisit this question about women elders from a Bible standpoint. Friend, I want you to know there's a reason why the World Church in General Conference Session has never approved the ordination of women to the gospel ministry. There's a reason for that. And the reason is because you can't get there from this book. Oh, friends, let's return to God. Let's be true to the Bible. Let's do what God shows us for elders and every other thing. And let's not go out and do whatever we want on elders, because that's a position of rebellion toward the Word of God and toward God Himself.